Okay, so how this memoization mechanism works when we have a recursive function? So there are essentially two ways to do it, explicit and implicit. And a very nice mechanism that some functional languages have is this automatic memoization, right? So the idea is that any recursive function can be converted into a memoized version, where the basic idea is that, you know, whenever you call recursively, you check if the value was already computed and stored somewhere. And if you computed it previously, you just fetch the value you computed it and you return it. Otherwise, you continue as in the previous version. So this is called the automatic memoization. And of course, we need to somehow implement this mechanism of memory, of remembering previous computations. So the automatic implicit memorization works by using a map data structure or a dictionary data structure that stores pairs. The pair is one side of it is the value, the Fibonacci number that's been computed, right? N is the nth number, and then the value of this number. Okay, and now what we do, we initialize this data structure to be empty, D to be empty in the beginning, and then we just try in the regular recursive function where we look up in the dictionary to see if the value is already stored, and if so, we fetch it. Usually, those dictionary data structure or map data structure implemented using hashing, and if it's not stored, well, so if it's stored, we just fetch it and return it. Otherwise, we compute it, and before we return, we store it in the dictionary data structure. Okay, so it's a pretty generic mechanism. And the nice thing is that you can apply it in some sense automatically without really understanding what's going on. On the other hand, explicit memorization is a bit more difficult because there what you do is you fill a table or an array in advance with value that says all values are not computed, and then the code looks roughly the same, except that to check whether a value is defined or not, you or was already computed, you look in the table in the right entry and you check whether the value is not equal to minus one. If so, it's already there, so you just return it immediately. Otherwise, you compute it and store it and return it, right? So this is explicit memorization. The thing with explicit memorization is that you need to kind of know in advance how big the table you need to allocate is and what its dimension, if it's several dimensions and so on, which means that it requires more work. And of course, you know, and in particular, memory allocation is something you have to take care of, while if you use a map data structure, all of this stuff is being taken automatically by the data structure. Okay, so it's quite striking to see the efficiency that you get from this memorization. So let's see the Fibonacci numbers case. So this is the recursion tree when computing Fibonacci number 7 without memorization. Right, an important thing here is that in the recursion, the color encodes the value being computed. And the important thing, of course, is that all those trees that have the same color in the root of there are, in fact, the same recursion tree, right? They're computing the same value. So when we compute the tree for the second time, we can just fetch the value if we did memorization. So let's see it in action. Right, the recursion first goes down, and then you start climbing back, right? So at that point, we store the value of 2 and 1 and 0, if they were not stored before. And now we go up, right? We call recursively on 4, 4 calls recursively on 2 and 3, but they were already computed, so they're being fetched without computing the recursion tree. And this continues in this fashion. Right, and you get this much smaller computation tree, right, which is kind of striking when you compare the two. It, of course, would become more striking if I used bigger numbers, but it's harder to understand what's going on with bigger numbers. Okay. So automatic memorization is a mechanism that is supported by certain programming languages, like Lisp and Scheme, functional languages, where the idea is that you can do it automatically, right? So you essentially can wrap a function. I give you a function, which in functional languages, a function, you can think about it as just an object. And then you can wrap this object with this memorization mechanism, this catch mechanism to check where the value is already stored. And what you get back, you get, so I give the your function, you wrap it around, and you get back a new function, which is a wrapped version that have memorization built in. So it's really nice because you can do it automatically on code you already wrote. So it's really very impressive. And essentially, the recursive version with memorization that is generated automatically, you know, essentially uses F as if it's already computed, it just return it from the value. Otherwise, it uses the new code, and the new code rewrites the old code. This is really the magic. Such as instead of returning the value, it stores the value and then returns it. Right. So when I saw this memorization mechanism when I learned Scheme a long time ago, it blew my mind because this is so much more powerful than anything you can do with standard languages like Scheme or, like C++ or Python, or I think even Python or Java, right? So this is kind of really striking. Of course, those programming languages tend to be not very efficient, relatively speaking, but, you know, efficiency is not usually that important for certain problems. Okay, so let's compare explicit and implicit memorization. Explicit memorization, you need to analyze the problem ahead of time, so you know what table to allocate and how to initialize it, so on. And but the advantage is that it uses memory more efficiently and the code generated code is more efficient. The implicit memorization is conceptually much nicer. You don't really have to understand what's going on. The data structure will take care of stuff for you. But you know, the code tends to be slow because you have overhead of data structure. And as I mentioned earlier, there are functional languages that provide automatic mechanism to do that. Okay, so here's the two examples of explicit versus implicit memorization of Fibonacci, right? The left side is the explicit memorization, right? We still have recursive code, but and we use an array to check the code, and then we fill it if we need to. While implicit memorization is, of course, recursive, but we just use the map or dictionary data structure. And if you think about it, as far as conceptually, the implicit memorization is easier at some level. But if you care about running time, you would do explicit memorization. Okay. So I want to finish this part with two questions. I'm going to answer those two questions in a separate video. The video was not going to be part of the lecture. If you want to see the answer, you would have to search to the video on the course webpage. It will be just in the next to the link to the regular, next to the link to this video. Okay, so the question, and this kind of question is going to be critical when we speak about dynamic programming later on. So think about the following function. This is a function that computes the binome T of B, T select B, right? So you can compute it using the formula that this is equal to T minus 1, B minus 1, plus T minus 2, B minus 2, right? Okay, sorry, T minus, what did I do? T minus 1, B, oops. Sorry, my brain was on auto, and the auto was wrong. Okay, t minus 1, b minus 1, and t minus 1, b. Right, now it's correct. This is the famous formula. Okay, so now let's, ignoring the size of the numbers, which is an issue here, but let's just ignore it. Assume that every arithmetic operation takes constant time. How many distinct calls does this perform? Right, so I'm going to compute binom n, n over 2. Right? So how many recursive call, distinct recursive call, this performs? Right? Okay. And you have the option here, the function is just the standard recursive function, right? Which we just call recursively, it's without memorization. But here we don't care about the running time. We care about how many distinct calls there are. Well, I remind you that if we the recursive function call binom, I don't know, 10, 5, it calls this, it does this recursive call 100 times during the execution. I don't care. I count it only at once, right? I consider two recursive calls to be different if the two parameters T and B are different. Okay, or one of them at least is different. Okay, so there are several options. N, n log n, n square, and then choose n over 2. By the way, here, n choose n over 2, this number is equal to roughly 2 to the n over square root of n. By roughly, I mean up to some small constant. So this is the largest binomial coefficient with rank n. Okay, so they said the answer, figure out the answer, because this is going to be important. Next question. What is the running time of memorized binom? Right. So now we took the binom thing, but we now memorized it. And again, I'm assuming that every arithmetic operation takes constant time. So, right, so as before, we have the function, we just added memorization. We have a map data structure that, or dictionary data structure that enables us to store the values if you computed them. And the question is, what is the running time? Now, to remind you, all the operation here, okay, ignoring the recursive calls, but all the operation here take constant time, right? You're adding numbers, you're doing some if operation, whatever. Everything is a constant time except for the recursive calls, right? So it's natural to ask, what is the running time of memorized binom? Okay, so figure this out. And this is it.